Chapter 1, A Tour of the World. In this course, we talk about macroeconomic issues of the determination of income and employment in the economy. The most recent event that has affected the field of macroeconomics is the financial crisis that started in the US and then spread to the entire globe. This event came as a surprise. The need to understand what happened is very important. So this is our starting point. Learning objectives. After reading this chapter, you should understand how the housing crisis in the US led to a major financial crisis, understand how the financial crisis turned into a major economic crisis, understand how the US crisis quickly became a world crisis. Learning objectives continued. Understand the current economic conditions in the US, Euro area, and China. Understand the pre-crisis, during the crisis, and post-crisis conditions in the US, Euro area, and China. Understand the two main issues concerning the US economy, Euro area, and China today. Chapter 1, Outline, A Tour of the World. 1-1, The Crisis. 1-2, The United States. 1-3, The Euro Area. 1-4, China. 1-5, Looking Ahead. A Tour of the World. What is macroeconomics? The best way to answer this question is to take you on an economic tour of the world. The goal of this chapter is to give you a sense of these recent events and of some of the macroeconomic issues confronting different countries today. The crisis. From 2000 to 2007, the world economy had a sustained expansion. In 2007, US housing prices started declining, leading to a major financial crisis. Collapse of housing prices caused major problems for banks because people stopped paying their mortgages as the value of their houses became less than the mortgages they had. Banks had bundled mortgages into complex securities packages which could not be valued easily. Banks began to collapse and other banks were unwilling to lend them in order to stay viable. This caused the financial crisis. The financial crisis turned into a major economic crisis with falling stock prices. In the third quarter of 2008, US output growth turned negative and remained so in 2009. Through the trade and financial channels, the US crisis quickly became a world crisis. The world economy had a sustained expansion from 2000 to 2007 as shown in figure 1-1. Housing prices in the US started to collapse in 2007, leading to a financial crisis which quickly turned into a major economic crisis that spread to the entire world. By 2009, average growth in advanced economies was -3.4%. Growth in emerging and developing economies stayed positive but was 3.5 percentage points lower than the 2000 to 2007 average. Since then, thanks to strong monetary and fiscal policies and to the slow repair of the financial system, most economies have turned around. Growth in emerging and developing economies has recovered but is lower than what it was before the crisis and has steadily declined since 2010. How the financial crisis turned into an economic crisis is shown in figure 1-2. By the end of 2008, stock prices in the US, Euro area, and emerging economies lost half or more of their value, causing consumers and firms to cut back on consumption and investment spending in the economy. Through trade and financial channels, the crisis spread to other countries. The United States. In the following sections, for each economy, we ask two questions. How big is the country from the economic point of view, and what is the standard of living in that country? First, we look at the United States. The United States is big. With an output of $17.4 trillion in 2014, It accounted for 23% of world output. The U.S. standard of living is high. Output per capita is $54,000, close to the highest in the world. Economists also look at three other variables to study the health of a country: output growth, unemployment rate, inflation rate. A map of the United States and economic statistics for the year 2014 are shown in Figure 1-3. The output for the whole economy was $17.4 trillion. The output per person was $54,592, and the United States output accounted for 23% of world output. The average output growth rate, unemployment rate, and inflation rate numbers for the U.S. economy for the pre-crisis years 1990 to 2007, during the crisis years 2008 to 2009, and post-crisis years 2010 to 2014 are shown in Table 1-1. During the crisis years, output growth was negative, unemployment increased from 5.4% to 7.5%, and inflation rate lowered from 2.3% to 1.4%. By 2015, the U.S. economy recovered nicely, leaving the effects of the crisis behind. Output growth rate returned to 2.5%, only slightly below the 3% average for the 2000 to 2007 period. Unemployment returned to pre-crisis level of 5.4%. Inflation is low. At 0.7%, it is substantially below the 1990 to 2007 average of 2.3%. Conventional expansionary monetary policy was used in the United States to stabilize the economy, as shown in Figure 1-4. The federal funds rate was lowered from 5.5% in July 2007 to nearly 0% in December 2008. Low interest rates and the zero lower bound. Why did the federal funds rate stop at zero? This constraint is known as the zero lower bound. If it were negative, then everyone would hold cash rather than bonds. Why are low interest rates a potential issue? Low interest rates limit the Fed's ability to respond to further negative shocks. Low interest rates may lead to excessive risk-taking by investors to increase their returns. Zero lower bound is a constraint since the Fed cannot increase aggregate demand in the economy by lowering interest rates any further. At negative interest rates, where people have a choice between holding their assets in cash or bonds, everyone will hold cash, which pays zero interest rate, rather than bonds. Conventional monetary policy becomes ineffective at this point. Although aggregate demand is important in determining the level of output in the short run, economic growth and the standard of living in the long run depend on productivity growth. Two main issues facing the United States today: low productivity growth and increasing inequality. Productivity growth is important for a sustained increase in income per person, but since 2010, it has been only about half as it was in the 1990s, as shown in Table 1-2. The slowdown in productivity growth is worrisome because the standard of living, especially for the poor, may not increase, leading to increasing inequality. The euro area. The European Union, EU, is a group of 28 European countries with a common market. In 1999, the EU formed a common currency area called the euro area, which replaced national currencies in 2002 with the euro. The euro area faces two main issues today: how to reduce unemployment, how to function efficiently as a common currency area. A map of the euro area with economic statistics for the entire euro area and some major euro area economies in terms of their size, output per person, and population is shown in Figure 1-5. For the euro area as a whole, the output in 2014 was $13.4 trillion, the output per person was $40,143, and the share of world output was 17.4%. While the United States recovered from the 2008-2009 crisis, output growth in the euro area remained close to zero between 2010 and 2014, as shown in Table 1-3. In 2015, output growth was below the pre-crisis average and the unemployment rate was 11.1%. Two main issues facing the euro area today: high unemployment and common currency. While the average unemployment rate for the euro area was 11.1% in 2015, countries like Spain had an unemployment rate of 23%. Much of the high unemployment rate was the result of the crisis. Even when Spain had its lowest unemployment rate of 9%, it was nearly twice that of the United States. Some economists believe labor market rigidities with too much protection for workers are the main problem. However, unemployment is not high everywhere in Europe, even though there are generous unemployment benefits and protections for workers. This leads to the question what these countries with low unemployment in the euro area are doing, and can that be copied elsewhere in the euro area? The unemployment situation in Spain is shown in Figure 1-6. Unemployment went up due to the financial crisis in 2008. Supporters of the euro argue there are economic advantages due to no more changes in exchange rates and its contribution to the creation of a large economic power. Opponents of the euro argue there are drawbacks of having a common monetary policy across euro countries with differing economic conditions and the loss of the exchange rate as an adjustment instrument within the euro area. China. China is in the news every day. Its population is more than four times that of the United States, but its output at $10.4 trillion is only about 60% of the United States. Output per person is roughly 15% of that of the United States. China has been growing very rapidly for more than three decades. A map of China and the economic statistics for 2014 are shown in Figure 1-7. Output in 2014 for China was $10.4 trillion. It is the second largest economy in the world after the United States. China's output per person at dollar-yuan exchange rate was $7,627, only 15% of output per person in the United States. And output as a share of world output was 13.5%. However, if purchasing power parity, PPP, measure is used to calculate the output per person in China, it would be $12,100, roughly one-fourth of the output per person in the United States. This is a more accurate picture of the standard of living in China. Why China is seen as one of the major economic powers in the world is shown in Table 1-4. Since 1980, China's output has grown at 10% a year for three decades, which implies doubling of its output every 7 years. This shows the strength of an emerging economy like China. China's rapid output growth has been driven by high accumulation of capital and technological progress, and China's transition from central planning to a market economy. The slowdown after the crisis is considered to be desirable as more of output would go to consumption instead of investment. Crisis slowed down growth, but not much because lower export demand was offset by increase in domestic investment demand through fiscal expansion by the Chinese government. Two main issues facing China today: slower growth, where does it come from? Transitioning from an economy focused on investment and growth to consumption. Looking ahead, we could also have looked at other regions like India, Japan, Latin America, Central and Eastern Europe, and Africa. You could have also thought about the issues triggered by the crisis, how monetary and fiscal policies can be used to avoid recessions, and why growth rates differ so much across countries. purpose of this book is to give you a way of thinking about these issues.